Welcome to Freedon Business. He grew up in South Florida, has been in business here since the early 90s, and has closed over $3 billion in deals. He's seen it all. He always has an opinion, and he's always ready to share it. Informed, entertaining, and connected, he has his finger on the pulse of South Florida's business community. He's Jim Freed, and this is Freedon Business.
Hey, everybody. Happy holidays. It's our holiday spectacular here on Freedom Business. We're going to start wrapping up the year by talking first with Kim Caviness from Familia Kitchen, our cooking expert. She goes over all kinds of great recipes for the holidays with a Latin flavor. And then people go, Jim Freed, you look marvelous. Well, the reason I look marvelous in part is because of my fabulous, famous dietitian, Ronni Litz Julien from Ronni Julien Nutrition. Ronnie's going to go over some of her tips to look good so you can get started early on all your New Year's resolutions. It's a tremendous show. Sit back and enjoy. Mr. Mendoza, take it away. Hey, everybody. Happy holidays from Warren Henry. When you're looking to buy or lease a car, you want to get every advantage that you can. That's why you have to check out Warren Henry, Land Rover, Range Rover, Infiniti, and Jaguar, and now Lincoln up at 151st and Biscayne. Up in Gainesville, they sell Audis. Down in the Keys, they sell them all. They're all great cars, and they all come with the Warren Henry Advantage. It's a long list of services. It includes, of course, a loaner car in case you have to leave your car there while it's getting repaired. Free loaner car. It includes, of course, we all know by now that I scratch up my rims a lot and they polish them up and make my car look fabulous and marvelous. Thank you for that, Warren Henry. And they'll replace those keys that I keep losing all the time. They're cost a fortune, but those guys keep replacing them for me. I want to thank them for that. And of course, more of the Warren Henry Advantage includes that they'll guarantee that you're getting the great price on your trade-in, best price on your new car, and to give you 72 hours to trade in that car. And guess what? Nobody ever does because they're great cars. They all come with the Warren Henry Advantage, like I said before. So join me, my mom, my beautiful wife, Vivian. We're all members of the Warren Henry family. You should be too. Always the best price. Always the best service. Always Warren Henry.
Carlson from Carlson Integrated. You know, a lot of our clients find that they can do anything, but not really everything. We are always excited to jump in and help. So whether you need another set of hands for a project or even comprehensive marketing management, our team of marketing mavens would love to have a conversation with you to see if we are the right fit. We do everything from logo and design work to email outreach and social media to writing and thought leadership. And here's a fun one. We are now offering our fabulous ebook of top 10 marketing tips on our website for free. So head over to carlsonintegrated.com and grab a copy today. And please always let us know how we can help. My email is Becca, that's B-E-K-A-H at carlsonintegrated.com. That's B-E-K-A-H at carlsonintegrated.com.
Hey everybody, happy holidays from Jim Freed here. I'm the founder of Sandstone Realty Advisors, and families from all across the world just signed up my new client from New Zealand, got clients in Australia. We do business in Latin America, Chicago, Texas, do it all over the country, all over the world. And we bring people solutions to their real estate problems. Real estate operating companies, high net worth individuals, family offices, institutions, work with all of them. What do? Well, I bring my gray hair to their problems. I help them solve their problems because I got all that experience. With the market changing, that's exceptionally valuable to a lot of different people. And remember, when you call me, it's always all about you. So happy holidays from Jim Freed and the folks here at Sandstone Realty Advisors and, of course, Freed on Business.
Welcome back to Freed on Business. Connect with us on LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter at Jim Freed or at Freed on Business, and on Instagram at Jim Freed One. Now, back to your host, Jim Freed.
Oh, this is a great holiday show. I'm very excited. We're going to welcome back Kim Caviness of the La Familia Cookbook. We're going to talk about some really wonderful Latino approaches to eating for the holidays. Hey, Mr. Mendoza, where's Kim? What's going on here? There she is. Happy holidays, Kim.
Happy holidays. Feliz everything. Here we go. Celebration time.
That's right. Well, we could say Feliz Navidad también, you know.
Can we say that? Okay. Feliz Navidad. Sure. Feliz Hanukkah. Feliz everything.
Feliz everybody. Have a great time. So, Kim, yes. Let's talk a little bit about holiday cooking. The Latinos down here in Miami always dig a pit and cook a pig. What other kinds of things do they do for the holidays? I'm all spun up about the Hanukkah stuff, but the Christmas stuff, help me out.
Oh, of course, of course. The holidays are huge, as you might imagine. Everything Latino, you come together with your family, with your friends, you get the music on, you start celebrating, and it lasts all month long. Where I'm from, Puerto Rico, we love coquito. You probably had that awesome Latino eggnog. It's got coconut in it. That starts pouring December 1, and you don't finish until Three Kings Day, which is January 6th. So it's a very, very long time. We also love, oh man, pernil is how we call lechon, you know, so there's a big, huge lechon that you see so much of in Miami in the big box, but we also do pernil. That's across so many Latino places. You basically marinate a delicious cut of pork with lime juice and orange juice and all kinds of great spices and herbs, and then slow roast that baby for 4 to 5 hours, and everyone loves it. Mm-hmm. Arroz con gandules is a big one, rice with pigeon peas. That's big in Dominican Republic. They call it guandules, arroz in Puerto Rico. It's just, this is the holiday where we just eat. Oh, and pasteles, you know, pasteles and tamales. That is the big family. Everybody gets together and you make your masa, stuff it with whatever you love, and then steam it.
It's Christmas Eve. We're here in Miami. What are some of the things that we can look for on the tables of our different neighbors? And maybe we could pick one and talk about how to make it.
Absolutely. I think, you know, really the big one is arroz con gandules, which I just mentioned. That just is, it's a dish that everybody looks forward to all year long. And it is delicious one pot dish with pigeon peas, which has this tradition of just being cooked. It's a simple food that was elevated with rice, and you put it all together. Sometimes you use like ham hocks and the like, but you know, it is December 24th to 25th when that dish comes out. And it's delicious. It feeds a crowd enormously. And then, of course, you have to have your main pork, you know, really, truly. So it is all about that enormous pig in the box in the back of your Cuban neighbors or the pernil. The house smells incredible. Everybody eats. And there's nothing really better either than a tamal. Like, you know, tamales for if you're Mexican, if you're from El Salvador, if you are from Ecuador, they go by many different names. But anything masa stuffed. Pasteles in Puerto Rico, tamales in Cuba, they're huge.
Let me ask you this, okay? Because I'm an Americano, if you couldn't tell. And I watch like the make tamales on like diners, like Triple D.
Yes.
I'm kind of confused because they use these like external husks that look like you can't eat them. What's with that?
This goes back to how people were cooking in the 15th and 1600s. You know, this is so much of Latino food really became in the indigenous roots of either it's the Aztecs or it's the Taínos where we come from in Puerto Rico, or it's the Incas. You bring forth these cooking. They didn't have plates. They didn't have forks. So what they did is they would literally make their food in the corn husk if you're from Mexico, or you take that big old banana tree,
right?
Plátano, your plantain tree, and you would literally, that was your plate. You would wrap it up in it. And if you had to walk a long time because you're hunting, you would wrap your food in that. They learned to steam. They learned to steam and boil, and that's how it cooks. So that's why it's confusing, because you're like, do I have to eat that? No, you don't. Literally,
it's just
the pan or the plate, and that's how you prepare the food. What's delicious is in the inside, and it is a dough. The dough is made with corn, mixed, you know, the beautiful masarina, if you're from Mexico, or it's yuca or plantain or some kind of a root vegetable if you're from the Caribbean. You stuff it with your delicious whatever you want to put in it, chicken, pork, beef, even seafood sometimes, and then you boil it. So what takes so long is making all the different things to stuff them inside, that takes like 2 days really by the time you get it together. But then, because you have to make the stew, let it cool, get the banana leaves.
What are some of the things that would be inside of that? Help me out, because we're just like bouncing from thing to thing, but we're not talking about anything in particular. What if you were going to? Okay. So yeah. It's December 23rd.
Yes.
I'm coming over to the Caviness house.
Yes.
I'm opening up the refrigerator and the freezer. What am I finding and what am I getting 2 days later?
You're going to find a beautiful, in my family, because we're Puerto Rican, you're going to find a huge cut, a shoulder, a pork shoulder, marinating. And that's it. That thing has been there for 3 to 4 days.
What's it marinating in?
It's marinating in my house. It's going to be a cup of orange juice, 2 limes, lots of mashed garlic, onion, bay leaves, adobo, our own kind of combination of salt and oregano and salt and pepper. That's it. You just wrap it all around in saran wrap and then tin foil. You let it, that baby just sit there for 2 to 3 to 4 days. And then
okay. It's December 24th.
December 24th. Noche
buena. That's my birthday. Happy birthday to me.
Oh, happy birthday. That's a great day to have a birthday on. Yes.
No, we could debate that all day. Usually I get a present. I feel guilty if I don't give somebody else the present. So, this is going to be a really good question. How about traditional holiday beverages? Tell me about some of those.
Well, but I'm going to first answer the question that you asked before, which is what happens on the actual day. So once
it's sorry, I forgot about that question.
That's okay. I'm going to get up really early. I'll be up, I'd say 8 or 9. I let that thing thaw for an hour so that it gets to room temperature. I get my oven really low, 325. I put it in there and it sits for 5-6 hours, depending on how many.
325 you consider low, because our oven turns on automatically at 350 and it seems like it never cooks anything at 350.
Yeah, there you go.
Slow, so yeah, right?
325 is low and slow. And that's, it's almost the same thing that you're seeing a lot with pork barbecue, but you're basically going to just cook that thing and then turn, baste it once an hour. And in 5 or 6 hours, it is fall off the bone delicious, but because it's been marinated in these really very traditional Latino spices and herbs and orange juice and the like, it is so good. And then the leftovers are even better because you have for days, for maybe anoches, you have like the pork sandwich. You can just like eat it in so many ways. It feeds a crowd. One pork shoulder really will feed 12 people, so it just goes so far. What are we drinking? It's all about coquito. Coquito is our famous, 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 the world's taken it up, but Puerto Ricans kind of invented
what
it.
What is it?
It's sometimes called Puerto Rican eggnog. It's basically, coconut milk mixed in with condensed milk, mixed in with eggs. And it tastes like the best eggnog you've ever had, but with a coconut edge with nutmeg on it. It is beyond. You see it chilling in refrigerators across all Latino families all December. And it is so addictive and so delicious and so fattening. It's why we all have to go on a diet January 1. But it is, you can't stop drinking it. They're beautiful. They're white. Just frothy, beautiful, Christmassy, holiday looking snow like things. And they're so delicious. So I would give you a big glass of that, Jim, and I would welcome you to my house and I'd sit you down and I'd invite you to my Christmas feast.
Ooh, thank you. Now, we talked about the pork, we talked about the eggnog. What about the rice? We talked in general about the rice. It had like pigeon. Help me understand what we should cook with rice, because I really like rice. My mom makes this rice casserole that I really love. So I really like rice and, it can be done with white or brown, I guess.
Yeah, white or brown. I mean, the traditional way is white. But, as with everything in Latino cooking, you have to begin with your sofrito. Sofrito is that cooking base of really finely chopped green peppers, ají dulces, or like these little sweet peppers, red peppers, onion, garlic, lots of cilantro. And then you usually make that. That is the base of everything. So you'll even mix that into your rice. Sometimes some salt pork, just delicious. And then you stir it all together. You cover it. You let it sit there forever. And then you throw in the peas at the last minute. And so it all kind of steams together. It is magical tasting. It is so savory and so good. It's all about, you don't just cook plain rice. You always put things in it and start off with this cooking base that's so savory and aromatic. And that's how you get it to be very special.
Now, how about vegetables? Do you have any vegetables that it's always good to cook?
I'm going to say no. You know, Latinos don't think about the vegetables.
They don't think about the vegetables?
No, it's all about that pork and the meat. I mean, in my American part of my cooking, yes, I love vegetables. But, you know, it's not like it's not a Thanksgiving mashed potato thing or a Brussels sprout thing. Really, we focus so much on that pork, that rice, yuca. Yuca is a root vegetable. So you often have fried yuca.
Or I love fried yuca.
Yeah, so that's what it is. But it's not like we have some healthy green vegetable. A green salad is often nice because you need that vinegar to kind of cut through all the starch. So people will make a lovely green salad with some nice vinegary dressing. But that's
so. How many people are coming over to your house, Kim?
Well, this year I'm going to go see my mom in Puerto Rico. So we're all heading down there. We'll be in Puerto Rico and the cousins, a million cousins. So it's going to be really great. I bet we're going to have 25 people, you know.
What's your mom's signature dish?
Her signature dish is arroz con pollo, rice and chicken, which is a traditional super mom dish. She also makes a pretty killer flan.
There you go. There you go. All grandmas make great flan. My mother-in-law makes tremendous flan as well. What's your favorite flavor of flan?
I have to say, I do love a pumpkin flan. Do you like pumpkin flan?
I really have never had that. I was thinking I like your traditional caramel. You know, I can't recall other flavors, but I know I've had them like probably passion fruit or something like cool like that I liked.
Yeah.
You know, so stuff like that. But really, it's whatever my mother-in-law wants to make. And part of the flan that I really like, there's usually like this like thicker part than the thinner part, the like thicker part. It's like a little bit more. I love that part.
Yes. You know, what's really important too is you have to have a shot of rum in it, like great rum that makes the flan just come alive. So my mom always said that. She always zested an orange and then put a shot or two of really good rum. So
you're from Puerto Rico. What kind of rum do you use?
I have to use one called Barrilito. Have you heard of it? Barrilito.
No.
It's a very traditional rum. They only sell it on the island, but it's been around for, you know, maybe 100 years. And their añejo is better than your favorite scotches. You know, it is beautiful. It is aged. It is incredible. Whenever I go, I always come back tons with duty free. Check it out. I might bring you back one when I go next time.
Well, it's time for us to take a break. I want to thank you so much for telling us your secrets about cooking in the Latino world. Kim Caviness of Familia Kitchen, thank you so much. We'll be back after this quick break. Hey, everybody. Happy holidays from Warren Henry. I want to start off by thanking our friends at Warren Henry, Eric, Larry, Ismet, Maytal, the whole team. They all treat me like family. They'll do the same for you. And remember, when you're looking to buy or lease a car, you want to get every advantage that you can. That's why you have to check out Warren Henry, Land Rover, Range Rover, Infiniti, and Jaguar. They just added Lincoln. Oh, boy, I can't wait to go up and check those out. They're all up at 151st and Biscayne. In Gainesville, they sell Audis. Down in the Keys, they sell them all. What do you get when you buy those great cars? Well, when you buy one of those great cars, you get the Warren Henry Advantage, a long list of services that includes a free loaner car. They'll polish up your rims if you scratch them up. They'll replace your fancy keys if you lose those. Of course, they'll guarantee you're getting the best price on your trade-in, the best price on your new car, and they'll give you 72 hours to trade in that new car in case you don't like it. And guess what? Nobody ever does that. They love those cars. So join me, my mom, beautiful wife, Vivian, lots and lots of my friends. We're all members of the Warren Henry family. You should be too. Always the best price, always the best service, always Warren Henry.
Can AI supercharge your real estate analysts? With DeepBlocks, you can now canvas entire cities in minutes. Search by total buildable, potential units, and uses allowed. Now live in 100 cities. Book a private demo and supercharge your real estate analysts. DeepBlocks.com/demo.
Hey, everybody. Jim Fried, founder of Sandstone Realty Advisors. I work with families, real estate operating companies, institutions, and high net worth investors from all across the globe to solve their real estate problems. Just signed up a new client from New Zealand. The word's getting out in New Zealand to work with me. We've got clients from Australia, too, Latin America, Chicago, Texas, Atlanta, all across the country. They all give me a call. I guess all across the world, you could say. They all give me a call to help them solve their real estate problems. They know that my personal brand is that I self-actualize by helping other people achieve their dreams and goals. Do that by, like I said, helping them solve their real estate problems. So reach out to me. Give me a call. And remember, it's always all about you when you call Jim Fried. And again, happy holidays.
Welcome back to Fried on Business. Connect with us on LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter at Jim Fried or at Fried on Business, and on Instagram at Jim Fried One. Now, back to your host, Jim Fried.
All right, we're here with our fabulous holiday cooking Christmas show. Where's Kim, Mr. Mendoza? There she is. We're with Kim Caviness of Familia Kitchen. She's got this great book. It's available at Books and Books. Now, Kim, tell us a little bit about your favorite recipes in that book that could be applied to the holiday season.
I have to say that it is going to be the coquito, you know, our Puerto Rican eggnog. We have a great recipe from here. It's family famous. We also have a great arroz con gandules, rice with pigeon peas, super traditional. There's some great flans, too. Flan is a great way to end your Christmas meal if you want something kind of light and delicious. And we have about three or four because it's that important across Latino cultures.
Now, do they have any baked goods? I'm kind of like a cookie and cakes kind of guy. Do you have like a cookie or a cake that you can tell us a little bit about that I can
take? I'm going to go with tres leches. Tres leches cake is one of my favorites. And we have a great recipe for it here in the cookbook. And it is one of our most popular recipes on the site. I made it just last weekend and people could not stop eating it. So tres leches cake, so beautiful. Kind of Christmassy. It's got that nice, beautiful white cape of snow on the top.
And if you add it, it can have red and green cherries too.
Yes, it can. We can go super holiday.
Now, they call it tres leches. Why do they call it tres leches?
They call it tres leches because there really literally are three kinds of milk in it. There's regular milk, there's condensed milk, and there's evaporated milk. And
what's
so that's a great question. You know, I really don't know. It's two preparations of milk.
I think that it's the amount of liquid probably because it's evaporated, condensed, and then regular. So I think that it's probably 3 degrees.
But you know, it's interesting. Evaporated is still a liquid, you know, so like you would think, but
partially evaporated, not powdery.
It all speaks to the hot weather that we have and the fact that it was very hard to keep milk fresh. And so literally they had to come up with these very smart ways of preserving and pressurizing these products so that they could be shelf-stable. And so that's why so many Latino places use condensed milk in their desserts, in their flans and the like.
That's fascinating. You know, I watched this show on the History Network, The Food That Made America and stuff like that. They did one about Little Debbie's and the guy increased the sales tremendously when he figured out he could put the Little Debbie's in cellophane and then they would last longer. It is all about that. That is what it's really all about.
History of food is so much about technology, right? And how things happen. And also, especially in Latino food, it's like that indigenous meets the Spanish, meets the African enslaved that were brought over to work on the farms. They contributed so much to the food culture. And it is this beautiful story of often, you know, troubled beginnings sometimes, right? People that came against their will, but then became part of the fabric and contributed mightily to what we think of ourselves as Latino today. So they all contribute in many ways to
What would be an interesting dish that has an African flavor to it?
Well, plantains. If you love plantains,
really?
You love, yeah. And sesame seeds, you know, oftentimes when you have mole, it's got sesame seeds on top. Those came from Africa. Coffee came from Africa. So many things that we literally, us also in many of the foods that we eat in Latino culture are made with humble parts of the animal that the Spaniards did not want to have. So they would be tossed away. And the people who worked in the kitchen would say, hold on. And they figured out how to make delicious porks of, you know, tough meat, sometimes tough pork or tough beef, but they would just slow roast it so long. So they became ropa vieja or the like, right? So we really have, and they're, you know, rice. rice, as we know how to make it, that steams up high, that is an African tradition. Rice, it cooks flat like paella. That's how the Spaniards made it. Rice would cook, the African tradition is to cook it high, steamed, and then let it sit. And that's how you get that fluffy, rice came from Africa. There you go. That's the biggest of all.
That's tremendous. Now, we've talked about Puerto Rico. We've talked about Cuba. We've talked about generally Latin America. What do you think is the country with that has the most interesting food? You can't say Puerto Rico.
I know. My mother's milk and my mother's food. I have to say Mexico. I'm really, as a Caribbean Latina, and I have a million Mexican friends, and I've always loved Mexican restaurants, but actually sitting with home cooks and seeing the incredible subtleties and sophistications of the way that they toast different chilies, different times, and the ingredients and how they spice things together. I've learned how to make my own tortillas. I'm just absolutely in such admiration and awe for Mexican cuisine and the complexity of it and how they pay such homage to the Aztecs and the Mayas, and those traditions have been brought forward beautifully. Tamales are not that different. One of the hugest foods in Mexican culture and legacy and heritage, right, is the tamal. And that is almost exactly made the way that the Aztecs made it in the 1500s and impressed the heck out of those Spaniards who were arriving. And here we are having the same dish and still serving the same for holidays. You know, that is the Christmas meal for many, many Mexican families.
Feliz Navidades.
Feliz Navidad.
So what would be a Mexican-centric dessert?
Tres leches is very popular and flan is very popular. So
those are the same ones?
Yeah, isn't that interesting? The food varies so much from country to country, but when it comes to desserts, flan is one of the ubiquitous dishes. It is a dessert found in almost every single nation. Of course, they have certain beautiful little cookies. Speaking of your love for cookies, they have different cookies and treats like that. But really, I think it would come down to flan. It would come down to tres leches. It's more really about the main meal when I think about Mexican cuisine. It is all about those tamales and all about the beautiful foods that you're preparing on the way up to that last dessert.
Now, tell us a little bit about your book and how you got the recipes in your book.
Yeah, so Familia Kitchen, this cookbook just came out. It makes a great holiday gift if you're still looking for those last gifts to give people. But this is a cookbook, familiakitchen.com. It's a website we started 2 years ago, and it was all about celebrating and capturing those recipes that are in danger of being lost, the ones that are in our abuelas' head. And I was looking for a recipe. I couldn't find it, and I realized all I have to do is ask an abuela. So it's taking oral history and capturing the family story and kind of going one family at a time and capturing the most popular, beloved recipes that we are cooking in the States when we miss home. And that is anybody who comes from a Latino place. You can miss home in Mexico, El Salvador, Puerto Rico, like me, but we all cook our way home. And even sometimes when we don't have the language, because generations after generations, maybe the kids don't know how to speak Spanish despite everyone's best efforts, but you can certainly cook your way home by making the dishes that have been in your family for a long time. That's what we're celebrating. You can buy it at Books and Books in Coral Gables. You can buy it at our website, familiakitchen.com. We'll sell it. And we're just so proud of it. And what we do is celebrate home cooks. Celebrate home cooks and abuelas and treat them. This is how we cook. And this is the best food that we make. And it brings us together. Even tamales, you know, it's a family activity. Everyone gets together and you make it together for 3 days. And that's what the holidays are all about.
Kim, we talked about the holiday traditions. What's your one favorite meal in the cookbook? Doesn't have to be holidays.
I am so obsessed with the pozole, Mexican pozole. We have two of them, red and green. That was a revelation to me that I could make those and not just have them at restaurants. And I love them. It's delicious. It's the kind of thing you want to have on New Year's Eve because it's very good for la cabeza if you had a couple coquitos too many. So pozole.
One last time, where can they get the cookbook?
You can get it at familiakitchen.com. You can find it right there. You can order it directly or locally in your world is Books and Books, one of my favorite bookstores in Coral Gables.
I missed you when you were here, but I had a conflict that night.
We really
wanted to get together. We'll see you on your next trip into Miami. I want to again thank Kim Caviness of Familia Kitchen, our holiday cook. Thank you so much, Kim, for being here on our holiday show with us today. Have a blessed Feliz Navidades. Did I get it right?
Happy holidays to you and your mom and your wife and everybody in your family.
Woo woo. We'll be back with more holiday show after this. Thanks so much, Kim.
Take care.
Bye. Happy holidays.
We'll see you again. Happy holidays.
Hey, everybody, Jim Fried here for Warren Henry. I want to wish everybody a happy holidays, and I want to make sure that you remember that when you're looking to buy or lease a car, you want to get every advantage that you can. That's why you have to check out Warren Henry. What a great idea for a holiday gift. They have up at 151st and Biscayne, Land Rover, Range Rover, Infiniti, and Jaguar. They just added the whole line of Lincoln cars. Can't wait to go up and see those. And they all come with the Warren Henry Advantage. That means you get a long list of services, including a free loaner car in case you got to leave your car, even for part of the day. What else? Oh, if you scratch up your rims, they'll polish them up for you. Do that all the time for me. I lose my keys pretty much on a regular basis, and they always replace them for free. In fact, they'll also give you, make sure you get the best price on your trade-in, the best price on the new car. If you don't like your car, you can trade it back for 3 days, 72 hours. But nobody ever does that. They love their cars. So join me, beautiful wife Vivian. Just got her the brand new QX60. What a tremendous vehicle that is. Me, my mom, my beautiful wife Vivian, lots and lots of my friends. We're all members of the Warren Henry family. So remember, if you're looking for a gift here at the last minute, go up to Warren Henry. And remember, always the best price, always the best service, always Warren Henry.
Carlson from Carlson Integrated. You know, a lot of our clients find that they can do anything, but not really everything. We are always excited to jump in and help. So whether you need another set of hands for a project or even comprehensive marketing management, our team of marketing mavens would love to have a conversation with you to see if we are the right fit. We do everything from logo and design work to email outreach and social media to writing and thought leadership. And here's a fun one. We are now offering our fabulous ebook of top 10 marketing tips on our website for free. So head over to carlsonintegrated.com and grab a copy today. And please always let us know how we can help. My email is Becca, that's B-E-K-A-H at carlsonintegrated.com. That's B-E-K-A-H at carlsonintegrated.com.
Hey everybody, happy holidays from the folks here at Fried on Business. I'm Jim Fried, founder of Sandstone Realty Advisors. People from all across the globe and all across the country give me a call to help them solve their real estate problems. They know that I have the experience that it takes here in choppy times as the market changes gears. Real estate operating companies, high net worth investors, family offices, institutions, work with them all. Solve people's problems. They all know that my personal brand is I self-actualize by helping other people achieve their dreams and goals. Let me do that for you. Reach out to me. Happy holidays. And remember, the person wants to do something finds a way, the other finds an excuse. Go out there and make it happen. And whenever you call me, it's always all about you.
Welcome back to Fried on Business. Connect with us on LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter at Jim Fried or at Fried on Business and on Instagram at Jim Fried One. Now, back to your host, Jim Fried.
All right. Thank you so much, Mr. Mendoza. We're back now with a guest that I think everybody really needs to hear. She's new to my life. She'll be new to your life, but she'll be a permanent component, I'm sure. We're here with Ronni Julien. Ronni is the person that's helping me get my life in order after the pandemic. Ronni, welcome back. Welcome to the show. She is right there. Hey, Ronni.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So I tipped everybody off, but not really. Ronni is helping me because I'm going to have to stand up for this. Because I'm thin on the outside, but fat on the inside. I don't really even know what that means. But my doctors told me I needed to work with somebody to switch my diet and get me away from all of the fancy deli and onto some more healthy stuff. Ronni, welcome to the show. Let's talk about what we're doing.
Thank you. Very, very excited to be here, Jim, actually. And the truth of the matter is we're really working very hard, especially people in my industry, to be sure that we look great on the inside, but look even better. Scratch that.
Look better on the outside. We're all good. We're all good.
That we're looking as good on the inside as we are on the outside. How's that?
Well done. Well done. Now, I eat healthy, at least I thought I did, at least up until the pandemic. The pandemic came and everything fell apart. I used to get up in the morning. I used to have my little drink. Then I'd exercise, have some coffee, go to the office, grab a bite on the way, have lunch at a regular time, come home at around 7 and have dinner. Perhaps not the perfect schedule, but it was a schedule. The pandemic hit, lunch went out the window. I don't know from lunch, okay? Breakfast, what's that? I don't go to breakfast anymore. So really, I'm stuck. And I started feeling, low energy, not able to focus. Ronni, softball, you take it from here.
Okay, so, needless to say, the pandemic did terrible, terrible things on many, many levels. Actually, in my own practice, I can tell you that between the gastrointestinal issues that people were having just from stress in the belly area, that really hit people hard. And the other thing is just what you're saying, is there was no schedule. People were home and they weren't getting groceries as often and they were afraid to go out. And remember that the mental health had a whole lot to do with that. And so people did not want to be on a schedule, and they didn't necessarily want to be eating healthy per se. In fact, it looked like there was somewhere around 15 to 20 pounds of weight gain on average during the pandemic. So it wasn't so wonderful on everyone else's end, but I had a lot of work to do with people dealing with pandemic and their lifestyle.
Well, I'm the opposite. I lost 30 pounds. I stopped eating. I worked out like an animal. At one point I was doing what I called two a days. I'd be working out for two and a half hours a day, end up giving myself a hernia, a double hernia, no less. And I hurt both my elbows. I'm going to have to go to the guy that works on the Marlins. He's doing one at a time, this one first. So, literally I'm going to get, they have carpal tunnel syndrome for your wrist. I got like whatever it is in your elbow. It's unbelievable. Yeah. When you hear him talking, you go down the hallway. It's all the baseball players. It'll be me too. Got news for you. I'm never going to get that fastball back. But Ronni, so let's take it one step at a time. People talk about the D word. And I'm not talking about definitive. I'm talking about diet. And when people are on a diet, they are set up to do the, I'm going to just do it, to lose. They're never going to get there. You're never going to get there. How do you make it not a diet? What do you call it? And what is it?
Well, we've talked about this. No, we don't like that four-letter word, and we don't use
friend.
It.
Now we're
right.
talking in front of my friends.
Right. So we're calling it lifestyle, or we're calling it your program. We're not calling it diet, because when we think of diet, we think of just what you said. We think of that bad news. And you know what? Year after year, there have been diets, whether it's keto or whether it's Atkins, or there's a million of them. I don't have to tell you. They came before I came. But the bottom line is, just as we have talked about, is how do we change the thinking about our food, our relationship with it, and how about our lifestyle?
You know, I think about it now. I have to admit it constantly. You're back there in the back of my head now, Ronni. I'm sitting there and I'm getting up in the morning. I still do my drink. I want to have my routine. So I probably am going to go across the street to Starbucks. If I don't go across the street to Starbucks, I'm going to a breakfast meeting, whatever. And I'm sitting there going, okay, what do I do now? I'm going to this breakfast meeting. A couple of years ago, before COVID hit, I'd just go to Green Street and I'd order coffee and some scrambled eggs and a English muffin. All good until we get to the English muffin, huh?
Yes. And one of those things that we're really working on, just for the insides of the body, of, as we have spoken about, is he's looking lovely, lovely on the outside. So we're getting it better on the inside, because the big buzzword today, Jim, is inflammation. And so every time, That's a bad word.
That's all I hear from my wife is, you know, whatever you're eating causes a lot of inflammation.
Yeah.
She doesn't really talk like that. She says, honey, that's going to give you inflammation.
And she does that with love, as you know.
She sure does. That woman has nothing but love. She's the love goddess.
The love goddess. So, yes, that is the big word. And we really feel over the last 5 to 7 years of good scientific research that most of our chronic conditions are based on the inflammatory process. So let's go back to the English muffin.
Yeah, well, hold on 1 second, because you're using the inflammation word. But really, the thing that causes inflammation, my wife is just, she should be in the back of me tapping her finger, I'm talking like her, is sugar.
Yes. So when we start with the white English muffin, what we now know is that when that digests and absorbs, it's turning to sugar as if you had eaten a bag of red Twizzlers.
Yeah, I like it when you use that analogy, because now I'm, you know, we had the break the fast and we had all the bagels and I go, honey, you bought me Twizzlers.
That's correct. That's right. Anyway, so we said
and
that.
And I went to her yesterday. I said, please, baby, next time buy me pumpernickel bagels. She goes, well, they don't have them anymore. I go, find a place that does.
Yes, we could talk about that. There are several in our area. But yes, the bottom line is good, complex, high fiber carbohydrates. It is no longer a problem that fruit sugar is the problem and fruit carb. I have people who don't want to eat carrots and they don't want to eat watermelon because it's loaded with sugar. Now, let's be honest. Is that really where the problem is? No, it's in the white bagels. That's right. Well, it is, and it's in the thinking of the white bagels and the white rolls and the white rice and the white pasta. And we have to understand that that is what digests and absorbs poorly. It affects our blood sugars. It affects our cholesterol levels. And it affects all of those conditions that we're really trying to avoid. And the truth is, the more we eat of the white flour and the sugar and the fried foods, and the red meat, I know we started to talk about that too. Yeah. Those are the things we call pro-inflammatory. And for goodness sake, the whole lifestyle change today is how do we prevent inflammation? And we can do it.
It sounds really important to do. And then when people realize how helpful it could be, that's great. But there is another thing that we have to worry about, and that's misusing the tools. Because what you do is you give us tools, and we have the tools, and the tools are great. And then we get all mixed up. So I'll give you an example. You got these great protein bars that you give me with lots of fiber. The problem is you got to know when to eat those. Can't eat that at 8 o'clock at night after dinner. You're going to have a problem.
So I find it very funny that a client had said to me a few weeks ago, also thinking that they eat very healthy. Well, now we were kind of doing some tweaks like we've begun to do because we need to change, just tweak the relationship with food and the choices that we make. And the client said, oh my God, everything counts. And that's true. Everything counts. Every calorie counts. Where we get it counts. And so you're exactly right. The body doesn't say, oh, this is a really healthy protein bar. Let me just urinate this out. It doesn't work that way. So that's true. We could be eating healthy, but we have to be very careful not to eat too many things that are too healthy because then that adds up too. Very often, I'll have people really, when you talk about misusing tools, we'll get back to that in a moment, but misusing olive oil, all things that are really healthy. But we're using 3 tablespoons in a salad, and we're really kind of frying.
You hit on my issue. You're dancing around the issue, but you're not saying what the issue is. And what the issue is it's how much. It's serving size. So, see, I've modified my diet almost to the point where I'm rhythmically correct, almost because there's always the days where you can negotiate with yourself to opt out and that's causing its own problems, which we don't need to talk about here. But the first thing you need to do is portions. Like, I get up, and so today I didn't go for breakfast. I'm going to go to synagogue, and I eat a bunch of nuts. Not enough, too many, the right kind. I don't know, but I ate them. It said eat nuts, so I ate nuts. Did I eat berries? No. So the answer is it's a combination of things at the right time that fires it all up, correct?
Yes, 100% correct. And you're really doing a great job with that, because like you said, you're paying attention to it. And awareness is already half the issue. Is we're thinking about it, we're planning for it. And so that's really helps us to get it right. So yes, you know, if you eat 10 nuts, you're going to be hungry in 2 hours, even though they're full of iron and full of protein and full of fiber. But the bottom line is we have to have enough protein and enough fiber and a little bit of good fat, because that's the combination that holds us several hours until our next meal. The other piece that you
hold
hit
on, hold on, no, no, no. Okay, before okay, we get okay. to the other piece, we're going to hold on.
I'm going to forget that other piece. Yeah.
Well, then talk about it. Tell me the other piece.
The other piece is recognizing, are we really hungry? Want me to hold on that? Or you want to talk about that now?
No, we're going to hold on that. We'll be right back with more with Ronni. What happens when you're hungry? Are you really hungry? Right after Mr. Mendoza proves what happens when you are hungry.
Hey, everybody. Jim Freed here for Warren Henry Automotive. They've been a sponsor here on the show for 10 now, going on 11 years. I want to thank all our friends up at Warren Henry, Larry, Eric, Warren, Ismet, Maytal. They're such great people. They treat my wife and my mom and me like family, and they'll do the same for you. Happy holidays. And if you're looking for a last-minute gift, hey, nothing's better than a car from Warren Henry. And remember, up at 151st and Biscayne, they sell Land Rover, Range Rover, Infiniti, and Jaguar. Now they've added Lincoln to that lineup. What a tremendous lineup of cars. Hey, if you want an Audi, they've got that up in Gainesville. Down in the Keys, well, they've got everything down there. They're all great cars, and they all come with the Warren Henry Advantage. That's a great list of services that includes, of course, a free loaner in case you got to leave your car. They'll polish up your rims in case you scratch them up. They'll replace your fancy keys in case you lose those. They'll guarantee you the best price on your trade-in, the best price on your new car, and they'll give you 3 days to make sure you like your car or you can give it back to them. And guess what? Nobody ever does that, because these are all tremendous cars. So join me, my wife, my mom, lots and lots of my friends. We're all members of the Warren Henry family. You should be too. Always the best price, always the best service, always Warren Henry.
It's time to stop the hate and spread some love. You are beautiful, you're smart, you are awesome, and you never have to change for anybody. You have the voice and you have the power. We are so much stronger when we come together. It's your choice, so choose to be inspired. Choose to be accepting, be strong, be brave, be awesome, be daring, be kind. Choose kindness.
Hey, everybody. Jim Freed here. I'm the founder of Sandstone Realty Advisors for many decades now. I've helped folks from all across the globe and here in the United States and, of course, right here in South Florida execute their real estate business plans. A lot of times, all I'm really doing is helping them solve a problem that nobody else could really help them with. Give me a call. Reach out to me. Remember, my personal brand is that I self-actualize by helping other people achieve their dreams and goals. So let me help you solve your real estate problems. Again, happy holidays, and remember, whenever you call me, it's always all about you.
Welcome back to Freed on Business. Connect with us on LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter at Jim Freed or at Freed on Business, and on Instagram at JimFreed1. Now, back to your host, Jim Freed.
All right, thank you so much. We're back again with Ronni, who is my person that's guiding me through my dietary evolution. Where's Ronni? Ronni, where's Ronni?
Ronnie's here.
There she is.
We're still working.
All right, Ronni. So we talked a little bit about no diet. It's a plan. It's a lifestyle. You know, all that other stuff. We talked about everybody got off their stick during the pandemic and did what was comfortable for them at that time. That's why average lifespan decreased. Now we're back here. We're out of the pandemic. I'm thin looking on the outside, but not so great on the inside, theoretically. And we're talking about what to do. We talked about fighting inflammation. And Ronni, now we're back up to you. Ronni, we were fighting inflammation. What's next?
Okay. So the way in which we eat, of course, it's we know now that fat, total fat, isn't the problem. Remember, if you remember, you and I were kids back then, when everything that had fat in it was bad. Don't eat it, non-fat, and the blah. Okay.
Yeah, so but then it became that everything with fat was good, and they were all eating, you know, like potatoes and I remember, you walked behind them at the buffet line. They'd eat 12,000 pounds of sausage, 12,000 pieces of bacon dripping, and they would eat the scrambled eggs, and they'd say, "I'm on a diet."
Yeah. So what we now know is eat the healthy fat because it's going to keep the heart well protected. And we know what those are, the olive oil and the nuts and the peanut butter and the avocado and all that really good stuff. But it's looking at those pro-inflammatory fats like the saturated fat and the beef fat and all those processed meats that you just mentioned. So all of those, you know, it makes me cringe a little bit when we talk about the regular keto diet type work is you could eat as much bacon, sausage, processed meats as you want. Well, it may make you like we talk about thin on the outside, but horribly inflamed and fat on the inside. So that's really important is that we keep those macronutrients in check so that we keep that inflammatory at bay. So we started with fat. We know to eat good fat. We must be the complex carbohydrate moderates. That's a good one. But the deal is we can't live without carbohydrates because you hear me on the one end saying, you got to do that exercise. You got to move. Well, our best source of fuel is still good complex carbs. So we get it from fruit and of course we get it from vegetables. Well, we get it from those whole grains. So the people that are really trying to live without good carbohydrates, 90% of those people are not really compliant, nor are they successful. So where are we? We are doing like I think we've talked about is our 80-20 rule. Can I throw that back to you? Do you remember what that is?
I know what that is, but our audience doesn't. So why don't you go into it?
I'm going to tell them.
It's my lifeline. It's my lifeline for reality.
Yeah, exactly. It is the way we do our lifestyle. And I bet you that it probably is going to work in every aspect of our life. And that is that 80-20 rule. And when we talk about food and nutrition and lifestyle, we talk about 80% of our choices being good, well thought out, healthy options. And then we play with 20%. And that's the way that this works. And it's the only way that works.
So, you know, everything must really taste bad, and this must really be hard to follow. But that's really not true. And it goes back to the fact that it's not a diet. You know, I sent my wife, the quintessential urban hunter-gatherer, out to help me put together my new menu items. Would I call them that? So let's talk about that a little bit. Like we said, I have this vegan drink that I drink first thing in the morning when I wake up that has protein, it has a little fat, it has a little bit of carbohydrates that gets me going. Then I drink water, I have coffee, then I, you know, go out. Usually now it's like 8:30, 9 o'clock. I'm meeting somebody for an early thing. I have a coffee with them, maybe a gallon, maybe 2 gallons, but anyway. And then I'm supposed to have...
They say the more the merrier. The more coffee you're drinking these days, the merrier.
Well, that's for sure. And then I'm supposed to have a break. This really doesn't sound like something somebody would anticipate doing. But I'm supposed to eat at like 10 o'clock in the morning?
What? So remember, too, that what's really great about people like us that our health professionals is the individuality of setting up somebody's lifestyle program. So when we talk about trying to kind of regulate blood sugars and stop people from being hungry and then making wrong choices is, as we talked about a little bit earlier, is that protein is a key nutrient. And one of the things that it does, besides keeping the cells healthy and keeping muscle healthy and well, is having protein. And we do that every few hours. A, it stops us from being hungry. And when we get back to our tools, we're going to talk about that. And that is, think about when we're hungry. I don't know about you, I'm going to eat everything that's not nailed down. So that's part of that planning. When we talk about having what we need available, like your beautiful wife goes out and makes sure that everything you need is in the house. It's the same kind of deal. You have to be planned, and you have to have what you need, and you have to be structured, because we don't want to get hungry. And so, yes, every few hours, the more protein that you infuse, the less hungry you're going to be, the happier your blood sugar is going to be.
Now, you can have all the pieces, but putting them all together is really not that easy. This is how I got in trouble just last night. I'd had a nice dinner, whatever. It's the end of the evening. I want to have a little snack. And I grab one of these bars. I grabbed the wrong bar. Okay. One of the bars is really light and fluffy and goes down easy. The other's like a Tootsie Roll. It's really, really hard. It takes like 10 minutes to eat. Now, it doesn't mean it's not good. It just takes 10 minutes to eat. When you're done eating that, you're in a different place than you were if you ate that little cloud. So, you know, part of it is understanding your tool set also.
Yes, 100%. So you're right. You know, there's every day, you know, you could open up the computer and find some new information. The newest information was eat earlier and eat over a span of 8 to 10 hours and then call it a day. So we're really trying, really the main reason for that is, who wants 500 or more calories at the end of the day when everything is kind of slowing down? That's probably the main chemistry of all this. But that's where that intermittent fasting came in, which was only eat for certain hours during the day. And people are still doing that.
I did that, not on purpose. I just did it. Because that was back in the pandemic. I just skipped lunch, skip breakfast. You know, I have coffee for breakfast. You have that drink. Then you go all the way from dinner to dinner. That's really not too good either.
Yeah, no, that's very true. Because things have to work in metabolism. And the only way we can keep there's a lot of ways to keep metabolism going, especially as we age. One of them is to eat. The more you skip your meals, the metabolism is going to kind of shut itself down or slow itself down, because you're still going and going, and you've got 200 more things, I know you, to do in one day. And if you don't have the fuel, then the body's going to go, all right, I got to chill here because I got a whole day to get to. So that's really what's important, is not to skip those meals. Even the intermittent fasting still remains somewhat controversial. Are we really getting all these 55 different little nutrients that our machine needs every day if we're eating from 11 to 6? Not sure. And so that new research says, eat earlier in the day, start eating at 8, stop eating at 6. And you certainly, that just seems just much more manageable and much healthier to me.
It's difficult to do that, though, to eat dinner from 5 to 6 really doesn't fit with the pace of most people's lifestyles today. So I think that's a little bit pie in the sky. At our house, we're trying to have everything finished by 8 o'clock at night. That's still not going to be easy because we don't even, you know, we're still trying to get the exercise in together, and that won't start till 5. That goes right from 5 to 6, 6:15, 6:30. You know, then you go try to start eating at 7 o'clock. It's really not that easy.
I hear you. We have to keep it as reasonable as, you know, there are 100 different things that we could do to make changes in our lives. And what we all do is we pick out the ones that seem to work for us, that we can manage. This is all about the management, correct? That's why it's a lifestyle. But remember, what we're doing is we're taking 30 and 40 and 50 years of habits, and we're trying to rethink them and change them. And so the longer that we can coach and cheerlead and educate you, the longer this is going to stick around.
Hey, everybody. I hope you really enjoyed the holiday spectacular that we had here today. I want to thank our guests, Kim Caviness from Familia Kitchen, who helped us cook like a Latina. And then we had Ronni Julien on. Ronni talked to us about how to manage your diet. She's my dietitian. She helps me look great. And I know she could do the same for you. We'll have more tips from Ronni throughout the new year. And I want to hope everybody has a wonderful holiday season. Everybody here on Freedom Business wishes you nothing but the best for you and your family in the coming weeks and in the coming year. And remember, the person who wants to do something finds a way. The other finds an excuse. Now go out there and make it happen. God bless you. God bless the United States of America. Mr. Mendoza, the rest is yours.